Thanks, Emily. Good morning or afternoon, everyone, depending on where you are. Thanks for this opportunity to hang on to talk about our work thus far. Got to get to the right place in our presentation. And so here we are. Okay, so this report, I wanted to frame around the idea from our local report in 1.0, the very lovely quote that we got from Levelyn Roan, who talked about the need for community level strengthening of the public health infrastructure. And he said, it's ground game 101, people, because this is Alabama and football is, you know, the metaphor, right? So we're calling this strengthening our ground game, this report on what it is that we're doing. Here's our team. We're actually a little bigger than we were for 1.0. Particularly, we've added Rich Krieg. I kind of shanghaied him to be our consultant and information sleuth and connector extraordinaire. We've added Carol Agomo and Samori Pruitt from our from UA's Division of Community Affairs, because this kind of work is really near and dear to their hearts. And then we've had the fabulous assistance of Mark and Divya, who are on loan to us from JHU. So our team has grown a little bit because that structural work just seems to take like more people. So here we are in all our glory. and so let's get right to it. I wanted to do a little reminder. I'm sure actually this group doesn't need to be reminded, but since you're recording this, we'll say it for the general audience. Alabama is primarily a rural state, and as most of you know, rural county populations tend to be older, poorer, and sicker. That's the case in the United States, and that's the case in Alabama. We are doing our work in the Black Belt, which is the name is because it was an agricultural region back in the latter part of the 19th century, and well, actually before that, for a long time. It was primarily an agricultural region, and the Black refers to the soil. But it also refers to the people, because the Black Belt counties are majority or plurality African-American, as is Pickens County that you see in the slide. It's 50% white, 40% Black, 5.2% Hispanic or Latino. And these profiles are part of the information that we prepared to sort of go out and do our work, to kind of give the counties a picture of themselves, not as though they don't know, but with the idea of saying, okay, so this is the information that's sort of out there. How does this jibe with what you know, what's missing, right? But back to Alabama, the other two things that are important to know about Alabama in the context of this work is that Alabama has a tradition of economic, political, and social disenfranchisement. And it's, you know, it's easy to say, yeah, it's Deep South, of course, but it's really important to appreciate how not only historical, but systemic these things are. And it figures in to the larger picture of why the local public health infrastructure in these rural, primarily minority communities is so poor, right? But the good news is that there's also a long and strong tradition of activism and advocacy. And I'm not just talking about the 50s and 60s, I'm talking about going back a ways in the cause of civil and human rights. And so the reason that we have to go out and do this assessment is because there are people out there doing the work, right? But without that support that allows that work to have its maximum reach and power. So part of what we're doing is documenting what's already being done and seeing what we can do to strengthen that. So our objectives with regard to Communivax, first, is to develop a framework for assessing the perceived needs for the type of work that community health workers do, particularly in, you know, high needs, low resource states like Alabama. Right? And we've done this by eliciting, or we are doing this by eliciting perspectives on community functioning, sort of a mid-level look at community functioning in key domains like health and wellness, rules and norms, governance and economy, and countermeasures are how you respond to potential or unfolding, right, negative circumstances. So we're eliciting that from our stakeholders. And we're doing that using a modified version of the Copewell self-assessment domains. And then lastly, and perhaps we were a little bit naive going in, we didn't realize that a good part of our lift would be identifying where community health workers are operating in West Central Alabama. And I'll say more about why that's a job in and of itself in just a second. Then what we want to do with that information that we've gathered is to share the results of the needs assessment, not only with folks in our region who are interested in building that infrastructure, but also as a part of the larger community health project, right? To sort of show this is one way that you can do this in a high needs, low resource state. And that sharing, in addition to sort of sharing out through the Communivax network at home, it's going to be sort of a convening of a group of stakeholders who are interested in expanding the reach and effectiveness of West Central Alabama's community health workforce. And these are just some of the things that have been mentioned by people that we've interviewed so far. There's interest in training. There's interest in fostering a network for resource sharing and support, for expanding the awareness of the role and the need for community health workers, and for making that the role of community health workers sustainable. So what have we done thus far? Well, we've prepped for our conversations, which, you know, sounds like a filler kind of things to say, but we have made use of the time that we have spent modifying the Copewell self-assessment and developing the county profiles that you have seen. We've also been reaching out to our stakeholders, and this has been a little bit of a challenge, not only because we're sort of juggling this with all of our other work, but because the community and faith-based organizations who are using community health workers are doing their work, right? So they're not necessarily the most, you know, the quickest about getting back to us, but we're starting to sort of make some inroads. But the advocates, the support organizations have been very responsive, and we've made significant inroads there. The researchers, primarily at UA, who are interested in this work, have also been super responsive. So we're encouraged by that. We've been learning from our colleagues. I say to my public health students all the time when I'm teaching health disparities, seek insight before you seek solution. In other words, don't just run out there thinking that you have the answer, but figure out what other people know, what other people are doing, what has happened. And Rich has brought that lesson back home to us, and particularly to me. And he has utilized his connections and skills with regard to sort of reaching out to people and also ferreting out information to help us gain some of that critical insight. I also want to do a shout out to Isabel, who has said to us time and time again over these months, don't reinvent the wheel, use what's out there. And Isabel, even though it seems like we didn't hear you, we heard you. And it's been really important because we've joined NACHW. We're sort of looking at the resources in a different way, right? To say, you know, what's already there, right? And we also had a great Zoom interaction with our colleagues in Louisiana who have been doing this infrastructure building work for about the past decade, and sort of having them tell us the story of their path has really helped us to think about what it is that we want to do going forward. So this is a little out of order and I apologize, but so just wanted to sort of give you a sense of the sort of the paperwork level or the assessment level. So my left is the Copewell self-assessment tool in its sort of original form. And this was as a result of feedback from some of our interviewees. We've actually sort of changed the look and feel of that assessment form to try to start a conversation with people, that mid-level conversation I talked about what does health and well-being in your community look like? So one stakeholder we talked with particularly gave us this idea of this arrow, you know, indicating a continuum, having people mark where they think their community is on that. And I just did an interview, actually Dr. Payne Foster and I just did an interview on Wednesday, and this was really useful. The outreach workers, AKA community health workers who were part of that group interview, really responded to the continuum arrow and were able to give us some useful information about why they see their community, you know, where they put the mark. And so it was great. It was a great conversation starter, in the way to exploring then, you know, is what you do community health worker work? And, you know, what do you need to be able to do that better? Is this important? Is it something that needs to continue, or does it stop with the project that you're funding for? So what we've learned, the first thing we've learned is identifying community health workers is challenging, in part because of that sort of multiple name thing, right? We found out that there are other systems out there that we need to sort of tap into to help us build a picture of what's going on in Alabama. Specifically, the Department of Labor actually has data on CHWs that that's been compiled from the National Association of Community Health Worker Member Database, right? So Isabel, you know, don't reinvent the wheel. Use what's out there. And so looking at that, what we were able to determine, not surprising, was that the registered community health workers are concentrated in the metropolitan areas. You know, Birmingham, Mobile, Huntsville, and more recently, Montgomery, because Partners of Health is launching an initiative to train community health workers there. And also, it's the name thing that we've had to put into our assessment to try to get people to sort of articulate what it is that they're doing, not identify themselves necessarily as community health workers, but articulate what they're doing as community health work, right? And as our colleagues in Louisiana said to us, there's no substitute for lead work. You just got to go out there and beat the bushes and find them, because they're doing the work. They're not sitting at home waiting to be recognized, right? And then there's a continuum of sort of prominence and organization among community health workers in Alabama. So doulas and birth workers actually have an existing support and training network, partially because of the nature of the work they do. They have to be trained, you know, to go out there. You can't just send somebody out who has, you know, a good reputation and is trusted in the community to help someone, support someone during their birth. They actually have to know stuff, right? And so Birthwell is that organization. And we're looking at connecting with them more substantively. We've identified a couple of researchers who work with them. And then substance use recovery peer advisors, another name for community health workers in Alabama, are actually funded by Medicaid through the state. And so we have an interview scheduled with the nursing faculty member at UA who works with this group to sort of find out how they got to where they are and how that might be relevant to what it is that we're trying to do. So that sounds really promising, but on the other side of that scale of what we've done are a whole bunch of unanswered questions. So because this is new ground that we're breaking in many ways, we kind of don't know what we don't know. but one of the questions that we were able to articulate is who are the essential actors, besides the community health workers who are doing the work, who are the essential actors in this process of infrastructure building? We've identified a lot of people, but really to be effective, it seems like we would need to know, okay, who absolutely has to be at the table? And we don't know that. And we also don't know, with regard to this convening that we want to do of stakeholders, what's a reasonable thing to expect that we can accomplish from that? Because, you know, it's going to be like herding cats and it's going to be kind of messy and, you know, but what's reasonable? Because reasonable expectations help people to sort of stay in the game. And so we're concerned with that. What are the implications for this for Communivax's work? We're in the weeds and it's hard to see what those implications are, but it seems that one of the things that might be important is formally documenting sort of the processes, not just our way, but the ways in which community health system building is done could be a helpful thing, especially for people who are where we are. And we know that those meaningful connections at multiple levels are really important to a viable local community health infrastructure. So, you know, we're bearing that in mind as we think about what are reasonable expectations, who needs to be at the table, and trying to remind ourselves that identifying and including those vital stakeholders is important. And so we need to do it no matter what we decide to do first, whether that's training, whether that's work on sustainability, whatever that is. So our contribution to Communivax 2.0, our deliverables are what you see, the assessment tools, the report, the convening process, this is how we did it. And then we just have to keep doing this work, collecting the data, processing the data, and then moving towards the convening. All right, that's it for Alabama. Thank you very much.